give myself to you.
One more time, say,
my life is not my own. To you I belong. I give myself to you.
We give ourselves away, Lord, so you can use us as your vessels to flow your love to this world that's dying and decaying. Thank you, God. So broken again by the tragedies that's going on in Memphis with officers who seem to just snap. One of my sons in the house, who is a U.S. Marshal, deals with stupid all the time, and as a former police officer, I also can remember being triggered by just the constant bombardment of sin and hurt and hate that people do that get on our officers and get on people who are on the front line. And we're so easy to judge them and their actions. But boy, think about some of the times you've been triggered by stupid people. Or just life itself got so hard that it just hurt you. So God, we do pause right now. I prayed for that scenario. Sometimes things I see on TV, I just wish I wouldn't have saw it. Sometimes ignorance is bliss. But God, we do live in a world we can't close our eyes to the things that are going on. God, not all officers are bad. Not all people who respond to crisis are so swept up with it that they forget that they're the answer because of it. But God, there is some time where tragedies and injustice happens and that your love has to reign. I pray for everyone involved in that scenario, and we're so quick to sue the city and sue people who, quite frankly, the very people that's trying to provide assistance in the midst of stupidity. And we let a few people so mark and so cover and mar the good that we only can concentrate on the bad. So may we concentrate on the good this morning as we send our prayers to that situation. Now, God, I could say I would hope that this would be the last time, but it definitely isn't. It's been going on. Sin is going to be here. Stupid's going to be here. People responding to the injustices in inappropriate ways. It's going to be a part of how we deal, God. So God, be with us, I pray, in Jesus' name. And we all say, amen. That is one of those downer moments that you think about what's going on in our society that just like so grips your heart to the point where you're thinking, God, what are we going to do? Is there ever going to make it be any difference? I really believe so. So I've been on this process, that this process of continuing in this process of fighting to finish strong with resilience. Introduction of this message again for those of you who may not have heard the introduction. I'm in this process that I'm speaking some things in the midst of my life cycle, because it does get hard to keep going, particularly when stuff like this keeps happening, that I will not quit. I remember why I started in the first place. Why to make a difference? Why is it we do what we do to show up in the midst of degradation and to show up in the midst of so much stupidity? When I was starting out with the Coats, we started bad. Told you last time, our motto, you could count on the Coast losing every Sunday. Every Sunday. This Sunday, they were going to lose. And we started with showing this video.
I want to encourage somebody out there who's thinking about quitting and giving up. Somebody who has been praying for years for things to turn around. And they're asking God, they're questioning God, where is it? What, when, where? Send me a sign. Send me a burning bush. Send me something to confirm that my hopes and my dreams and things that I want to accomplish are going to actually happen. You're thinking about quitting. You're thinking about giving up. This is for you. Don't give up. Don't give up. Stay in it. Stay focused.
You know, life can throw you some curves. And it's not just the things that you see coming, but sometimes it's the things that you didn't see coming that hit you out of nowhere, that set you back in such a way that it seems like you can't get over. And we, you know, are dealing with a lot of normal times where people feel like already their plate is full. And then all of a sudden out of nowhere, there comes these unexpected things that just make us feel like we're overwhelmed. And you've reached your limit. And your bandwidth is full. And you already said, I can't take another thing. And then out of nowhere, here comes something you didn't see coming, and you're in it. This question, am I going to make it, is something that each and every individual is asking themselves all over this nation and in many places of the world. And in your homes, somewhere in your heart, these words are echoing, am I going to make it? Somebody needs to know today you're going to make it. Somebody needs to know today you're doing all right. You may not be what you ought to be, but you're not what you used to be. And you're going to get there by God's grace. Don't you give up. Don't you quit. And don't you keep putting yourself down. You're doing better than you think you are. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 gives 28 times and seasons in life. It says there's a time to be born, there's a time to die. There's a time to laugh, there's a time to cry. There's a time to dance, there's a time to mourn. There's a time to gather, there's a time to let go. It's 28 different times in life. The one time I can't find in there is the time to quit. There is no time to quit in your life in this. If you'll keep going, that's how you get to heaven. Tell somebody, this is no time to quit. You may have bars, you may have chains, but you're still blessed.
When you come into a season of struggle like you're in right now, do not be defeated, because if you're breathing and the sun is shining, then God has a purpose for you.
You're still alive, so therefore God is not done with you. You're still here. God has a plan for your life. God has things in mind for you beyond anything you could ever imagine.
Shake off feeling sorry for yourself. Shake off don't nobody love me talk. Shake off all of that talk of, you know, being a victim. It's time to encourage yourself in the Lord. Stand up to life. Stand up to this challenge and encourage yourself in the Lord. It's bad. We've lost a lot. And we don't have a guarantee of anything in the future except God is with us.
The person who prevails is the person who refuses to give up. The person with the mental toughness is the person who will triumph. The testing of your faith produces perseverance. The man who can get up one more time than the time he's knocked down is going to be the winner. Being knocked down is not a problem, but staying down is a problem. Get up! Because success begins by getting up one more time than you've been knocked down. The Bible declares in Proverbs 24:16, listen to this. For though a righteous man falls seven times, he rises again. For though a righteous man falls seven times, he rises again, again. You're not a failure for falling down. You're a failure for staying down.
You know, it's amazing how many people in the world have done phenomenal things, after having failed numerous times in their life. And so failure doesn't have to be the end. Making mistakes doesn't have to be the end. I think most people, if they're going to be successful, they have to press through some things. And one of the things that we tend to do, or that one of the lies that the enemy tells us is, well, there's just no way. There's no way. There's no way out. But we have to remember that there's always a way out. And those of us who are believers in Jesus Christ know that he said in John 14:6, I am the way. We may not know the way, and he may not be telling us the way, but he wants us to believe that he is the way maker. God will make a way for you, but he does require you to never give up.
If you invite Jesus in, if you passionately get on your knees and pray, you invite him in, he will show up. And he will literally make a way out of no way.
He's always there. Sometimes you don't feel he's there. Sometimes you wonder, where in the world of God are you? He's always there. You remember that verse? I will never leave you nor forsake you, period. You cannot walk through one moment of adversity as a child of God without his presence. I will never leave you nor forsake you, period. Not except if what? No. A child of God is always in the company, in the presence of Almighty God through his Son, Jesus Christ, who lives on the inside of us. What an awesome assurance.
Don't give up on yourself, because if you do, then what you're saying is, God's not big enough to change me. There's nobody that is beyond change. God can change every single one of us. I don't want you to give up. I don't want you just to throw in the towel and quit. If all you can do right now is just get out of that bed and walk across the room, do something. And if you'll do what you can do, God will do what you cannot do.
Those of you who may have seen that for 3 or 4 times, you ask, why do you keep showing it? Because how many people saw it for the first time this morning? See, for those of you who forget that everything, this really does not evolve around you or us and our agenda. It's about the bigger picture. You never know what someone is going through that needs to hear. Every time I see it, every time I hear it, it does something to me a little bit more about reminding me of who I am and what God can do. And this statement just leaps in my brain, giving up is simply not an option. No matter what, it's simply not an option. Martin Luther King said it this way, if you can't fly, run if you can't run, walk if you can't walk, crawl, whatever you do, just keep moving forward. We've been talking about the spiritual checkup, and if you hadn't got this list of accountability questions, we'll have some in the back for you. And I'm going through this kind of sparingly. And it's changed since I started, because I was going to try to just get through it real quickly. I'm thinking, Mama said, slow down. And go through each point a little bit more. I'm thinking, because we need a checkup. Who's checking you up? Because that process that we really don't do what we preach and people preach. I want to do what I've heard. You know, I've heard to do good. Knowledge is not my power. Application of the knowledge is my power. I know right from wrong, but sometimes my sin and my nature just prompts me to do wrong. I know that's just me. You don't have those issues. I know most of y'all have arrived to perfection, but guys like me, I mean, I still have a tendency to get a little upset sometimes. I have a tendency to be a little lazy, and so as a result of that, you know, you hear people preaching, you know, that preaching will facilitate great things, right? It motivates people to do their best and results in a healthy culture of performance, creates a clarity of expectation, and we set the standards for all around. But see, what you tolerate accepts this process of low performance and behavior. fosters a sense of complacency. It allows a group of low performers to drag everyone down. And the overperformance of the team and organization creates confusions around expectation, and it allows double standards. So I've had people in my life to try to help me pull my standards up, because quite frankly, I hate accountability. I hate people in my business. I do. I just can't stand it. I just get out. Ain't no business how I'm doing. Just leave me alone. Like, I'm okay. So I need something, and the word helps clarify for me. Therefore, brothers and sisters, make every effort to make your calling and election sure. If we do these things, we will never stumble. You will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. There is a process that we must go through. I started with, when we first started, have you spend time in prayer. Every morning, that those of you who are on my prayer list, you get it. I don't miss. Unless I'm sick or I intentionally take off. But for years, I've just ever been very dedicated to sending the word out. Have I had any lustful, tempting thoughts, exposed myself to any explicit materials, wouldn't glorify God? I had a long list on that one. Basically, have I made a covenant with my mind and with my body and with my eyes, and I don't want to not glorify God? Have I been completely above reproach in my financial dealings? And not only do I tithe and give back to the Lord, but do I help people? Am I a blessing to other people? Have I prepared an inheritance for my children's children? Have I broke the cycle of generational curses of abandonment and not having anything? And am I now can become the lender, not only just be the borrower all the time? That process, have you spent quality time with families and friends? Wow. You look at that process. You got time to go through it again. And I talked about covenant relationships. I talked about different types of relationships that you have. I talked about doing 100% best on your job. One first one there, last one to leave, one with everybody else. I believe they have these in YouTube as we've broken them down. This process of being champs or chumps, you make the difference. CHAMP and CHUMP. Not in what you say, but in what you do. We went from count on coach losing every Sunday to winning a Super Bowl and praying around the Lombardi Trophy because we just didn't quit. We never gave up. Last week we were talking about, have you told any half-truths, outright lies, putting yourself in a better light to those around you? Are you a person of integrity, doing the right thing? Not just when it's convenient, but because it's right. We talked about that aspect of integrity being the foundation by how you live your life. And today, wow, have you shared the gospel with some unbeliever this week? My wife asked me, what in the world does that have to do with finishing strong? I generally would glance over this one. I really would. Generally, I would just glance right over this one until I really start understanding the significance of why this is so amazingly important. Three reasons that we shell our faith. Hell is real. Bible commands it to do so, and it strengthens us. I love this process. Preach the gospel at all times. When necessary, use words. How do you share the gospel with people? I'm hoping that it's in this process that you'd rather see a sermon than hear one any day. I'd rather you should walk with me than merely tell the way. Eyes are better, pulpit, than more willing than the ear. Fine counsel is confusing, but examples are always clear. What are you doing? What are you doing? Because you know your actions speak much louder than your words, much louder. So when I thought about this, I had all these processes and thinking about what we could do and what we could share in reference to, you know, the people in my life, and, you know, they will know we are Christians by our love, they will know we are Christians by our love. How in the world can we relate to this thing of what in the world does that still have to do with us finishing strong, Pastor Kent? Wow. My wife questions just messed me up this morning and totally transformed the message. Because she asked me this question. And so I had to go back to a time that I first remember not having any hope. I'm 62 now, so I have to go way back. And so my wife and I did some training when we started this process to plant a church. And so we were in this group of people, and they says, where were you when you were 8 years old? I'm like, whoa. Dude, I start crying. I said, what's wrong? Because I was in an attic. My mom had just got sent to a mental institution for shooting the guy who gave me his name, because he shot my older brother up with heroin. And the police came and got her. They came and got us. We went to stay with our aunt, who was a wicked woman. And she kept us in this attic. And I turned 8 years old in the attic, eating dog food mixed with some weenies and sausage that she fed us in this attic. My brothers and sisters was in this attic with us. And I went back to that moment, that I was just like, it just hit me so hard, like, woo, I got traumatized. That trauma just came back in this meeting in front of everyone. And I was like, whoa. So they say, write a letter to your 8-year-old self based on where you're at now. So I went back to my notes. I'm thinking, dude, that's deep, bro. Like, really? So this morning, I updated the letter. This morning, I'm thinking, I'm updating the letter. And so I'm trying to get my message. So I'm updating this letter to myself at 62. The letter goes as following. Because I'm thinking, should I just show my testimony? I was like, just read the letter to him. Like, that's not... Now, I want you to know, it's probably not one of those, I'm definitely not a traditional Orthodox kind of preacher, dude. I'm just not that guy. I'll tell you that right now. Y'all know that. You know, I'm just, what you see is what you get. You know, no pretense, no airs. It's just, I'm an open book. And so as I started reading this to myself, see, my story, my testimony, at 62, to my 8-year-old self, to the 8-year-old boy who, on his birthday, was in an attic eating dog food, hungry, hopeless, with his 3 brothers and 1 sister, hoping and wondering, where was my mom at? 54 years now, God is literally blowing me away. I want you to remember then, son, all you need to praise God is a good memory. Your life is going to turn out. It's going to be hard, and many times you're going to want to quit. But remember, just keep your faith in Jesus and keep on going. It's all going to work out for the good. The best is yet to come. Remember way back when your first scripture verse was Romans 8:28. We know that all things work for the good for those who love God and called according to his purpose. He got a purpose for you, boy. He got a purpose for you. God has a purpose for you. In 1968, you were lost in Los Angeles. Your mom was a prostitute, and she had multiple relationships. He was in the mental institution, and she shot the man who gave you his name. And your 10-year-old little brother at the time, he was older than you, got shot up with heroin. You don't know why that happened. Guess bad things do happen to good people sometimes. The same year, your mom and the 4 other siblings got on a bus from L.A. to Dallas, Texas. Remember your mom sleeping with a guy in the back to get some money to feed y'all? Your grandfather, who raped her when she was a little girl, who got her pregnant by her, that your oldest brother was a product of, met y'all and took you to Uncle Bill, the lady's thrill. If he couldn't please you, no other brother would. That became your motto in life. He became your role model. 9 people in a 1-bedroom apartment. You moved over 18 times before you graduated high school. 1973, your uncle turned you on to drugs and a woman. And some things you know you're going to read in church that some young people don't need to hear because they justify their imperfections on your past stupidity. So be very careful. You're going to read this at church today. You committed your life to Christ, but you would have no real disciple or discipline in your life. You just went through doing whatever you wanted to do. Your uncle became your role model. Church became duplicity because he was a preacher, a pusher, and a pimp. So sports became your outlet. Your identity was through athletics. In 1978 through 79, your senior year, you had rose to the top and was one of the blue chip All-Americans in the nation. The first district game, you broke your neck and you were paralyzed from the neck down. Put you off, and all of the teams who were calling for you, all of the teams who wanted you, dropped you like a hot potato. All the people who said they would be with you, all the people who said they had your back, turned their back on you. But miraculously, that year God healed you. You came back strong, and by your senior year, you had won district in track. You're going to be fine, son. Just don't give up. But you turn your back on God because you thought only about yourself. You became wild and unselfish. You put the Bible back on the shelf, and you only concentrated on yourself. You grew to hate white people, especially the people in the church, because you thought they all were a bunch of hypocrites, just like you were. You'll make it a part of your life mission to give all the white people in your life as much hell you can master up. You will do a lot of things that will give the devil glory, but it won't take long for all your stupid stuff to catch up with you. You can't put it all in this letter because it's too much to glorify the devil. Just know, wow, you've been saved by grace. Bottom line, you're going to do some crazy stuff. But you'll discover, even when you had given up on God, he never gave up on you. His spirit was still in your heart. Even when you prayed that prayer way back when you were 13 years old, you would get sick of being sick and tired of being tired. Your sin, you're going to find out, is going to take you further than you wanted to go, keep you longer than you wanted to stay, and make you pay much more than you want to pay. You will find that sin just don't play. You're going to have to pay a cost. Even going to have a child out of wedlock while you're in college. There's going to be a process of transformation that's going to take place in 1980 and 82. Will be a start of transition for you. This will be a crossroad experience where you really go in through a military experience. You go through basic training in Fort Ben Harrison. You meet this girl before you leave, and she becomes an intricate part of your transformation. You rededicate your life to Christ through this country white boy named Bob Owens, who simply loved the hell out of you. At the camp, you will make a commitment to feed the good dog for the rest of your life. Most people don't know what that's going to mean when you read the letter to them today, but most of them who heard the message know exactly what you're talking about. Your life won't be perfect. It will definitely not going to be the best that you think it should be, but it's going to be much better than you could have ever imagined. Romans 12, 1 and 2 will become your life scripture verse at that age. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God, for this is your proper act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is. After you make that recommitment and dedicate your life to not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, from 82 to 83, people of your past will start asking you this question. What makes you think you can change? You just given the word of God by saying, therefore, in 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone. Behold, the new has come. God's going to make you new, son. God is doing a new thing. The summer of 1982, you go all in. You come back to school. You dedicate your life. You start leading hundreds of guys on your team to Christ. You start sharing your testimony throughout the entire city. People look at you and think, how in the world could God change somebody like this crazy dude? You become a great leader. You start traveling and sharing your testimony. 7 months later, that girl you met before you left, you go marry that girl on February the 19th, 1983. And you will marry this amazing woman. And she will be the love of your life. In 1984, you'll graduate with honors, staying committed to Feed the Good Dog. Your nickname will become Bird, because you will have the ability to run fast and you sing real well. They'll love when you sing. You didn't think God could use you. In 1984 through 1990, you become a police officer. You work 6 years, and at the same time, you will go through the process of getting licensed and ordained as a minister of the gospel. Your nickname will become preacher on the streets, because everyone who you meet, everyone who gets in your car, everyone you come across that you arrest or have conversation with, you will share the gospel with them. You'll even get called to the carpet by your supervisors telling you, you got to stop preaching to people. You got to stop not writing tickets because they come from the inner city. You gotta be what we conform to. You start an organization called SHARE, Stand, Help, and Rid Evil. You become president of the Black Officers Coalition and the president of the Police Coalition for Christ. You help many people find their way through life and through hope. You lead moms, your mom who shot you when you was a senior in high school. You will marry her and your stepdad, and they will stay together until they both die. You'll have 2 more children. You become a licensed and ordained minister, chaplain in the U.S. Army Reserves. You will become an individual who dedicated his life traveling the nation. As a police officer, tons of people will be transformed by the hope that you give them. Your life scripture verse will be, for those who wait upon the Lord shall renew thy strength. They will mount up with wings of an eagle. They shall run and not go weary. They shall walk and not faint. You will write a book called Journey to Excellence and sell thousands of them as you travel around the country. You will do your first album with Bill and Gloria Gaither and use that album to sing at Promise Keepers conferences in 1992 to 5,000 pastors and 25,000 men, and come back the next year and sing to 50,000 men, I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh, my soul, rejoice. Those men, full stadium, will just be up raising their hands. Oh, poor black boy from the ghetto, leading worship to 50,000 men. And because of that one opportunity, you'll travel the nation for the next 30 years, speaking and singing in conferences and doing things you could have never imagined. Your life will become a miraculous testimony that nobody will believe, not even yourself. You will be married 40 years to the same amazing woman, have 3 adult children. One will end up in prison. One will end up gay, marrying a woman. And one will lose his way but come back to God. And God will show you how to love all people through the brokenness of your heart by your own children. You will stay married 40 years to that amazing woman, 30 years as a chaplain, planning an inner city, multicultural, multi-ethnic, multi-generational, mission-shaped, outreach-focused church, dedicating on living to love God, ourselves, and others. You have a not-for-profit that you started in 1992 that will give millions of dollars away that you collected as you were traveling and as you were working with the Coats to help hurting people just like where you come from. You'll prayerfully work to inspire and motivate godly leaders to work together to help make the world a better place for everybody. They'll even talk about doing a movie that they'll start the funding on and run out of money and can't finish it. You will do exceedingly abundantly more than you could ever ask, think, and or imagine. At 50, your life scripture verse was 2 Timothy 4:7-8. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there's in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. But not only me, but also for all who long for his appearing. For years you will pray to work to help men become better godly men. You will dedicate your life for the cause of Christ. And at the same time, your profession will be fight to finish strong, live to love, stay hungry, humble, and hopeful. Know that we have power to win, and we are better together. But we have to come together to be better, because the devil is doing everything he can to tear us apart. You will live a life that at the end of your life, you want just two words on your tombstone. Told you. Told you God was good. Told you our God is amazing. As I was writing that, thinking, you going to read that in church? Well, I guess I am. Is that going to be a part of your message? That's just who I remember who God called me to be, even when I didn't think I could be anything. We have an awesome, amazing, mighty God. But this will be by this. They will know that you are my disciples. If you have love for one another, I think about the brothers who are left out in this letter, about all the people, amazing friendships that I have for years. This amazing opportunity. See, when you get a certain age, really, all you really need to do to praise God is reflect back with prayer and petition with thanksgiving. God has left us. He has left us as the remnants. He has left us as the ambassadors, the people who bring forth the good news. He commands us through the power of God to use our lives. It can be used in ways that can truly make a difference. Jesus replied to those, I tell you, unless you're born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Something happened to me when I really rededicated my life. God became just my source when I began to feed that good dog inside of me. How can a man go back to his mother's womb? Jesus replied, I assure you, no one can enter the kingdom without being born of water and the flesh and the spirit. Humans can reproduce, only humans, but the Holy Spirit gives spiritual life. So, don't be surprised when I say you must be born again. That was only my claim to fame, y'all. I just submitted myself to Christ and let him be God in me. This process of being his disciple. I want to be a disciple maker and an earth shaker. I want to use my life simply to make this world a better place. How do we share the gospel? How do we share the gospel with someone? Preach the gospel at all times, and when necessary, use words. Does your life speak for itself? When I read some of that, how many of you knew any of that about me? You've heard it before. When I read it, I'm thinking, I read it and lived it and, like, tripping on it. Like, dude, for real? Really? And what's crazy, the best is still yet to come. Not in heaven either. Not in heaven. Right here on this side of earth, as long as I'm breathing, every morning I wake up, I anticipate God to do something that continually to blow me away. I can't believe I'm standing here as a lead pastor. Our church may be small, but I thought we get to go love some folk today. And it's not about the number. It really isn't. I'm so past that. I woke up with, I get to go love some folk today. Not got to, get to.
whoever show up, just love them. Give them the best that you have. So we ain't got a worship leader. So keep going. Keep loving. Just keep on going. This ain't the first time you've been challenged by anything. It won't definitely be the last. Just keep on going. Do the best you can while you can. May your life be a testimony to others.
I want to end.
That you share your gospel by simply being the upcoming attractions. What does that mean, Pastor?
I'm glad you asked. You go to a movie, they show a trailer, don't they? If you go to a movie, generally, when I started going to a movie, when I was at, like Fang in them age, you know, they didn't show like 30 minutes worth of trailers. They show just a couple of them to whet your appetite to come back and get a picture. The moviegoers choose a particular movie based on the genre of the preference, you know, the what they believe, the type that they like or they satisfy. The trailer provides the moviegoers with just a sample. Get you excited. They try to relate to your style, the kind of that motivates you and what you can expect in the movie. They won't show it all to you. They just give you a little bit. To whet your appetite. And when the movie trailer, when you see it, the first minute you will either become attracted by it or repulsed by it. And if it's not what you like, like some people don't like scary movies. I'm like, I'm not trying to go almost pee on myself in the show when I ain't trying to do that. No, you know, I ain't trying to go. And, you know, I watched this thing last night that Denzel Washington did. And, man, it was so sad about black people who went past white to assimilate, to fit in, even to the point where they had to degrade other black people. I'm thinking, dude, why watch that stupid movie? I don't want to watch the movies that make me remember the past. So I don't gravitate to them because something happens to my spirit when I watch the degradation of how people were treated. When I saw the police officers beating them, something just happened to my spirit. I ain't feeling that. You know, I like goofy, crazy movies sometimes. I like, you know, love stories. You know, I love the Notebook. I love the Notebook, dude. I just love that movie, man. That was such a great. I didn't think I'd like a chick flick like that, man. Like, oh God. I could see me and Mama D just going to sleep one day and waking up in heaven. Wow, that's kind of morbid, but still. This process of church. Three main reasons I believe we come to church. Godhood, brotherhood, sisterhood, and service. When people tune into our life, we are representative of what heaven's going to be like. I pray my life is just a precursor. That God can be better. Doesn't matter where you come from, that God can use you. Doesn't matter what sin you've come from. Doesn't matter what degradation. Doesn't matter what somebody say about you. If they think about you, it's what God says about you. What God has for you. Not what man, because no matter what you do, you can't please all men anyway. Not even the person that you look in the mirror every day. But you do have a God. That loves you and does exceedingly, abundantly more than you could ever ask, think, and or imagine. That's why we around here always say, if you're in Christ, you're a new creation. The old has gone. The new has come. God, this is one of those messages that I just got changed today. I got all these notes about things you can do and messages you can share and different formulas, and you have me just simply read a letter. And I'm constantly rewriting to that little bitty boy who was discouraged at 8 years old, with no hope. I'm 62 now, Father God. There are people here that life has challenged them, and they're in a position where, quite frankly, it's just difficult sometimes. And it's because of your grace, Father. It's because of your love. There's some young folks here, God, that can't really grasp half of what I'm saying because they just ain't lived nothing yet. It's kind of foreign to them, some of the concepts that I may be even talking about, but I'm here to tell them, no matter what happens, in your future, don't you give up. Don't you allow the circumstances of this world that become hard to discourage you to the point where you quit, that you think about checking out, that you think that you're not worthy of God's grace and God's love and God's mercy. None of us are exempt from consequences of stupidity. None of us are exempt from the pressures and processes of life. This song, I sang it once before. I just feel led to end with this song. We talk about God's amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. If it wasn't for God's grace, wow, I can't say I don't know where I'd be. I know where I'd be. I know exactly where I'd be, Jack. But by his grace. Listen to these words. Find the song, Johnson. There it is. Measured out my days, life carried me along. In my soul I yearned to follow God, but knew love that be so strong. I looked hard at this world, learned that heaven could be gained. Just to end where I began, where human efforts all in vain were, it not for grace I could tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, where my salvation up to me, and I know that I would go the battles I would face. So here is all my praise, expressed with all my heart, offered to a friend who took my place and ran a course I could not stop. And when he saw and threw just how much his love would cost, he still went the final mile between me and heaven, so I could not be lost. I could tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, where my confession led to me, and I know how that would go, the battles I would. Forever running, but losing the that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Everybody, please stand. Lord, as we thank you, Father, as we end, that's why we have to love God first. We love God with all our heart, mind, soul. That's why we gather here, brotherhood, sisterhood, godhood, friendships, servitude. This location is only the place that we gather to remember that. Wherever we do that, that never changes. Wherever we do it, that mission never changes. Does it become more convenient or less convenient? Possibly. Does the facility make a difference sometimes? Absolutely. I'm not an idiot. But it does not have little or nothing to do with what you do with what God has given you. You are the church. We are the church. When we show up, that's how people get it. By how we love one another, encourage one another, empower one another, staying in fellowship with one another. So when God fills us correctly, he heals us from all our scars, from all the stupid that most of us can get so involved with. I'm sorry, me, not you. I know y'all don't deal with none of that stuff. Y'all got it on. Guys like me, I just needed more help, Jack. And God showed up and showed out, and the best is yet to come. So out of that love, love others compassionately. Love others with the love of Christ, and they will know that we are Christians while we love one another. Repeat after me, up, in, and out. That's how you share the gospel, up, in, and out. Lord, thank you that we stand in your presence. God, we got another opportunity today. God, it could be so much better. I'm always complaining that it could be better, needing help to sing. Somebody come help me sing. I love to sing. I love what Miss Vanessa did last week, Sean, whoever. Even if you just come up here and struggle, help a brother out. Amen, God. May we love each other in this process. God, thank you for the visitors today. God, those who may not know you in the pardon of their sins, all they simply got to do is simply say, Christ, come in and fill me. Those who may be watching this on the thing we call YouTube or technology, God, this has nothing to do with location. All you got to do is proclaim to a God who is everywhere, I want what that brother just preached about. Help me, fill me, be in me what I can't be in myself. So God, be with us as we break this huddle to go into this world to love you like we love ourselves. And out of that overflow, we give you glory. In Jesus' name we pray. We all say amen. God bless you. Hug somebody before you get out of here. And if you need prayer, I'll be up here and I'll pray for you. Yeah, but don't forget to give your offering in the back, too. I always forget to say that thing. Bless you.